أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقية لأعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد، sisters and brothers in Iman, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. We are towards the last ayat of Surah Al-Qiyamah, Surah number 75. I think the screen is just blank. Inshallah, the remaining ayat, we will deal with that tomorrow night and conclude that surah. Tonight we'll look at four more ayat, ayat number 31 to ayat number 35 actually. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins by saying, فَلَا صَدَّقَ وَلَا صَلَّى ولكن كذب وتولى. He neither affirmed nor he prayed, rather he denied and turned away. ثم ذهب إلى أهله يطمطى, and then he went swaggering to his family in an arrogant manner. أولى لك فعولى. So woe to you, woe to you. ثم عولى لك فعولى. Again, woe to you, woe to you. Now, this is actually a continuation of the people who were described previously. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about those who were the deniers and how what will happen to them and this their state of sakaratul maut. Last night we looked at the ayat. Their inner eyes will open up. They will come to look at the reality. And they will have no way of changing things. And that's where we look at the description in the sayings of the Ahlul Bayt, that when they talk about the deniers and the munkireen and those who are non-believers, their state of death would be more, a depressing with a kind of agony. Whereas a mu'min, a true mu'min, he goes through that. In one of the hadith of the imams, besides what I recited last night, was that for a mu'min, going through that process of maut would be like changing from, his or her old and dirty clothes and putting on a new cloth. So it will be kind of a, positive experience for the mu'minin, inshallah. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues with their attitude, and he says, those who did not believe, فَلَا صَدَّقَ وَلَا صَلَّى. He neither affirmed nor he prayed. We are talking about tasdeeq here, and tasdeeq in the sense of, rejecting the qiyamah. That is the main theme of this surah. And the people, especially the immediate audience of this surah, were the people of Mecca. So for them, the main issue of rejection was the issue of Qiyamah. Of course, that leads to rejection of Nubuwwah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then that also, goes to the level of denying Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا صَلَّى, nor he prayed. Now, nor he prayed. But if he didn't affirm the aqidah, there's no sense in expecting them to pray. But this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to highlight that tasdeeq and to affirm the aqidah is not sufficient. And one example, one very obvious example of affirmation of Tawheed and Nubuwwah and Qiyamah is the issue that a person starts doing the prayers. That's why we see that, you know, when you look at the belief system, you have one list. When you come to furu and amal, practice, the very first item is salat. Namaz, you know, roza and fasting comes later on. Hajj comes later on. Zakat and khums comes later on. Jihad comes later on. But salat is umududdin. It is the pillar of our faith. In one of the hadiths, it says that, you know, umud is this pole that you put right there in the middle when you erect a tent. And the reason why salat is known as that, it's as if, you know, the tent of Islam is standing on that pole, which is known as salat. If that falls down, then the tent will collapse. And that is why we are told that on the day of Qiyamah, you know, in qubilat ma sawaha, if salat is accepted, then the chances of acceptance of other deeds are more. And if the salat is rejected, then a person is in trouble there. And this is such an important issue that there is no, you know, compromise or leniency on this issue. There was a tribe which came to Medina to the Prophet. This is after Sulh Hudaybiyah, now that, you know, the power of Islam was kind of increasing. And so there were many, many tribes in the Arabian Peninsula outside Mecca and Medina who were just sitting and watching. And they were saying that if Islam gains power and comes up, we will join. So for them, the issue was not haqq and batil. It was more to see whether it's gaining, you know, a strength and power in the society, then we'll join. So they are those who just go with wherever is power and might. And so one of those tribes came, the delegation, they came to the Prophet, and they wanted to negotiate their Islam. They said, you know, we will accept Islam, but, you know, there are three things we want from you. Number one, okay, we will worship God and not the idols that we have, but we don't have in our heart that willingness to go and smash and destroy the idols. We don't want to do it ourselves. So Rasulullah said, okay, on this one, I'll send my people. They will go and destroy it. If you feel very bad about it, you know, you know, they might have some feelings about them. So he said, okay, you don't want to do it, we'll do it. Then the second thing they said, you know, we should be allowed to continue our habit of zina. He said, absolutely no. And the third, we want exemption from salat. And Rasulullah says, you know, la dine. There is no religion which has no salat in it. So salat basically becomes, the daily prayers becomes the symbol of the faith. And if you remember in the wafat of Bibi Khadija, I had mentioned that, you know, if a person joins the Jamaat prayers, then there is no need to ask that person whether you're a Muslim or not. Because joining the Jamaat prayers itself is a sign that this person is a Muslim. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى. Rather, he did not affirm, he denied the reality and the truth. وَتَوَلَّى, and turned away. It's interesting that the words, you know, لَا صَلَّى, and here it's تَوَلَّى. Tawalla here, not in the meaning of tawalla and tabarra. No, this is a different, you know, format of it. Tawalla means to turn back. Salla is what? What do you do in salat? You actually face, in a way, symbolically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the opposite of that is turning away. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that these are the people who denied, and they turned away. ثم ذهب إلى أهله يتمطى, and then he went away. This is specific example of the person where the ayat were revealed. One of the mushrikeen of Mecca. Then not only that, they were denying the basic aqidah and not praying, but even their behavior was arrogant. Even in the way they walked, away from the Prophet. They would show there, you know, we don't really care about you. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala notices that also. وَذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ. And he went away to his family. يَطَمَطَّى, you know, in an arrogant manner. And so this is, you know, one issue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't really like any attitude or behavior of arrogance and takabbur and ghurur. Salawat upon thee, Barak. He is very severe about it. Very angry. He say, woe to you. And then again, awla laka fa'awla. Thumma awla laka fa'awla. You know, basically what it means here that you indeed deserve the punishment. Awla, you know, you are more deserving of something. Now, he doesn't mention what. He doesn't even describe. There is a reason behind it. He says, you just think. You are the denier. You think what is going to happen to you. I'm not even telling you. Because if you already know, somehow mentally we prepare ourselves even to go through the torment of whatever kind. And here Allah is kind of putting them in a more distressful situation that you can sit down and you can imagine what is going to happen to you. And he repeats this again and again. أَوْلَى أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَى ثُمَّ أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَى. So, you know, don't be afraid this issue of la'nat is part of the Quran. This is another way of that Allah doing the la'nat to those who are the deniers and repeating it four times in just two ayats there. Salawat. Inshallah, the remaining ayat will deal with that tomorrow night. It's a very beautiful passage, and this is the beauty of the Quran. You know, you might start with one theme, or one you know, way of presenting that theme, and the conclusion always, you know, goes back to that same theme from a different angle and perspective. One question which came 2 days ago was the issue about is there a namaz radde mazalim? I think under one of the ayat, was not relevant to the theme itself, but yes, it was an example about the issue of radde mazalim, which means that if we have wronged somebody where we don't know, maybe we had done it, or we are not sure about it, or we know but we don't know the person at the moment, he's not accessible, or we know the person, but we don't know how much, you know, the liability is upon us. And one of the ways of dealing with that is to pay radde mazalim, which means you pay an amount as a sadaqah on behalf of that person. And that is to be practically, when you do the payment, is to be treated like sahmi imam. And so that's the way you know, we look at radde mazalim. So somebody asks, is there a namaz known as namaz radde mazalim? So instead of paying, you just do the namaz to get rid of all the zulm. That mazalim means zulm, the wrong that a person has done to somebody else, which is to be recited on the last Friday of the month of Ramadan, or some other time. Well, I looked at it from very early books of, you know, du'as and amal. Sheikh Tusi, who lived 1,000 years ago, founder of the Hawza of Najaf, Misbah al-Mutahajjid, which was the Mafati of those days, Mafati al-Jinan. Till you look at Mafati al-Jinan of Sheikh Abbas Qummi of our era. Even I was glancing through yesterday before I came onto the podium, Wazaiful Abrar, a very common book of du'as and amal that we have in Urdu. I wasn't able to see anything about namaz radde mazalim. There is radde mazalim is a process, but namaz radde mazalim is is not there, and so whoever talks about it, you should ask for a reference. I even looked at the question-answer section of the Maharaj's website, especially Ayatollah Sistani's website. There is nothing like Salat Radd al-Mazalim or Namaz Radd al-Mazalim. There is no mention of that at all. You see, this is an important issue when we talk about Radd al-Mazalim, and I wanted to just briefly elaborate on that. A person might have done wrong to someone, and it is not possible to fulfill his obligation or seek the victim's forgiveness. I'll just give an interesting example where someone else has mentioned. For example, you were a madrasa teacher, not in Canada, but back in East, where you could punish the students. Or you were a teacher in the school, not just in a madrasa. In the Eastern societies, the teachers felt it is their right, and parents actually would have no problem if they punish their students. But Sharia has certain rules and regulations. Number one, you need, as a teacher, you need the permission of the wali, of the child, whether you can exercise physical discipline or not. That also has a limitation. Even the father, for example. If the child does something wrong and he becomes angry and wants to, slap him, even the father, as a wali, has a right only to slightly spank the child only 3 times in one go, not get out of rage. And that also in a way that it doesn't, leave marks and bruises on the child. When we talk about examples of child abuse, that is really extreme. But Sharia doesn't even allow the parents to do that, let alone a teacher. So you were a madrasa teacher or a school teacher in those days. It wasn't any ill intention. You were thinking, it's for their good. And now you come to realize that that was a zulm you had done. You taught for 15 years. So many, 100 children, now they've all gone through, grown up. Many of them might even appreciate your discipline. They will say, that discipline brought me back to track. But the point is that you did that, and that is considered to be one of the mazalim. How do you deal with it? You can't go and find them. Especially in that example that I presented to you, you have, multiple cases there. And so one way of dealing with that would be, to go and pay something that you feel will fulfill your obligation towards that individual on his or her behalf, to pay this in the sadaqah on their behalf. And so this is what is known as Radd al-Mazalim. Of course, when it comes to the actual implementation of that, how you spend it, it has to be the same method which is used for Sahmi Imam, and it should be dispersed according to that. Now, let me just further, talk about it. Now, we are talking about monetary right. I don't want to scare the parents. I'm not saying, go home and sit down in front of your kids and say that, maafi, talafi, and sorry, and forgiveness. But keep that in mind. It is an issue which has to be kept in mind when we talk about dealing with others, including the family members. Now, looking at monetary rights, violation of that. If you know the amount and the person, then there is no issue of Radd al-Mazalim. You know the amount as well as the person who, you have obligation to that person, you have to go and return. If you don't have the ability to pay that, you have to go and seek his forgiveness, so that the obligation is gone. If you know the person, but you're not sure of the amount, it was many, many years ago, then you still have to go to the owner, the person, and try to compromise with him. That there was an amount, you don't remember, I don't remember, but I remember that I have to pay to you. And if a compromise can be reached, that's fine. But if there is dispute going on, unresolved, then both can refer to Hakim Ishara, a religious authority, who will listen to both sides and basically fix the amount which has to be paid. Number three, you know the amount, but not the owner. Whether you forgot it, 30 years have passed, for example, you don't remember, or you don't have access to that person, you don't even know the person's heirs. This is where the issue of Radd Mazalim comes in. This is where you have to then pay that off as Radd Mazalim. Let me look at a couple of other examples or situations. I talked about it briefly because one of the issues in Khums, this is from my book on Khums, where one of the items is that if halal and haram wealth is mixed, that you cannot separate one from the other. These scenarios would come there. In a case where a person cannot, doesn't even know the amount, or the owner, but he knows there is something which has to be paid, and he knows it is in his part of his wealth, then one way of dealing with that is actually to pay, because he has doubt about what he owns now. Is it halal or haram if it is mixed? And one way, if he doesn't know the amount and doesn't know those who are rightful owners of that and everything is mixed up, then the only way to purify would be to give khums from the entire wealth that a person has. And so this is one issue as far as Radd Mazalim is concerned. Another question which was not asked, but it comes up, mashallah, social media and internet are good things, but also creates misinformation. Sometimes, without ill intentions, but people just have this habit of whatever they hear, they just forward it. And some people actually use that mechanism to talk about issues where they don't have the reference, they don't have the issues. One of the things I hear is, Mawlana, there is a namaz to be recited on Jumatul Wida, which is known as Qaza-i Umri. Which means that if you recite that namaz on that last Friday of Ramadan, all your 70 years Qaza namaz will be forgiven. And my response is, I studied about 10, 11 years, never heard about it. How come I didn't know that shortcut? We talk about the salah, that if you didn't do it, you have to do qadha. If you cannot do the qadha in your own lifetime, you have to, arrange something in your will for it to be fulfilled after you. So I don't know where this comes from. People always look for, a shortcut, which is really not there. Probably it's like, saying that, if you do these things, the sawab will be 70 times. In Ramadan, you do something good, it will be 70 times. It doesn't mean if you do two rakat namaz, nafila, it means you have done, 70 times number of rakat there. No, it is the ajr and sawab which is multiplied 70 times, not that act. And this is where we have to keep in mind that, our obligation, especially when it comes to the salat, it is an important issue, because the earlier ayat for tonight was beginning with the issue that, the person did not do tasdeeq, did not affirm wala salla, and did not even pray. And so it is an important issue, and there is no shortcuts. Of course, if a person has many, many, qaza prayers, they should learn the shortest way of doing qaza. But there is always a problem with that. Don't get used to it. You know, it is only when you really have to, you know, go through many, many prayers, which has to be done in qaza form. Otherwise, when you go back to your own normal prayers, you recite it the way you normally would do. Inshallah, we'll conclude here. We still have time, about 5 minutes. Any questions? The question is about the qadha prayers. Do you have to do it in the order? Fajr, Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, or you can just do, you know, Fajr whole year and then Zuhur next year or something like that? No, it doesn't have to be in the order. You can do it in whatever way you want. It's always easy to, if you have the time, to always do one Ada prayer and then the Qaza with that. But that becomes more challenging if it is a midday time and you have to do Zuhur and Asr, whether you have the time to do. But this is what I say always that when you do the Nafila prayers, try to use that time to do the Qaza prayers. And inshallah, if the intention was that, oh Allah, I wanted to do Nafila prayers, but I have outstanding prayers, and therefore I'm doing the qaza now, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His grace and His mercy and bounties don't have any limitations. He can, you know, reward you for both. And so that's what you should be doing. Yes? When it comes to non-Muslims, whether you had to do Radde Mazalim for something you took from them, if they are, number one, if you live in a Muslim country, and if they are Ahl al-Dhimma, means the Muslim government kind of has covered them as far as their, you know, their life and property is sacrosanct. And similarly, in the countries where we are as a minority, but we have an understanding, a legal understanding of respecting the laws which do not violate our Sharia. And it's not a society which would be known as Kafir Harbi, those who are openly hostile to Islam and fighting against Islam. In those kinds of situation, and probably Canada would be that, if somebody has taken something from a non-Muslim, then even that has to be paid off in form of Radde Mazalim. You see, if there was a time when people had this misconception, if I say that, oh, Mali Kafir is halal. Well, there is a difference between Kafir Harbi or a kafir who is a dhimmi, or a muahid, or even those who are just in what we call in the state of amn, you know. There are some maraji who actually say when you come into a country and sign the immigration paper, or, you know, sign the document of citizenship, this is kind of a agreement between you and that society. And so the property of others also becomes sacrosanct. And this is where we to realize that, you know, it's not that, you know, a free ride for us just because they are kafir. because that mentality then extends. You know, hirs and greed doesn't have any limit. Today I say, Mali kafir halal. Tomorrow we'll say, okay, we have those Muslims who don't have wilayat of Ahlul Bayt. So the circle will extend. Then we'll say, okay, we have this Shias, they only show up here on the day of Ashura. You know, And then that circle would just expand. And this is where we have to be very careful. Our Prophet was known as As-Sadiqan Al-Amin. And he was Al-Amin for the property of Mushrikeen. One of the reasons why he left Amir al-Mu'mineen back in Mecca was so that Ali would, you know, take all the amanat that the Prophet had and give it back to those who were honors. So Ali on that night did not only save the life of the Prophet, he actually saved the reputation of the Prophet as Al-Amin. It's not only that, you know, he by sleeping on that bed, you know, he protected the Prophet. No, he even protected the reputation and image of Rasulullah as Al-Amin. And that is what we have to always keep in our mind. Well, Radd Madhal is to be used as Sahmi Imam, so it doesn't go to non-Muslim. In Sadaqah, there is a category whether you can give to non-Muslims or not. The preference would always be our own people, primarily Shia, then Muslims. And in the list of the recipients of Zakat and Sadaqat, in Surah At-Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about a group known as Mu'allifatul Qulub. Means those whose hearts are inclined towards Islam. They are not Muslims yet. And so there is a potential that if you help them out, you know, that might bring them more closer to Islam. Those non-Muslims can be helped with sadaqat. Yes? Yes, you can pay the Radd Mazalim on behalf of the deceased also. No, no. It's a very case by case, person by person. So, ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار برحمتك يا رحمن الرحيم.